Welcome to the Subcommittee of the Health and Human Services Committee. I'd like to ask Senator Setzler to open us in prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, giver of all good things, we just praise you and thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We pray, Lord, that we would be mindful of the least of these, Lord, that you've called us to serve and be mindful of. Pray that we would humble ourselves before you, pray that you give us the wisdom that only you can give. Bless these proceedings today, that we would ask hard questions.
We have one bill on our agenda today, House Bill 520. The hearing is being live streamed. We're going to have the bill presented, starting with Representative Jones, Chairman Jones, and Representative Oliver. Okay, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. What would be the, I'll say, first indicators or second indicators of mental health or substance abuse? Madam Chairwoman, that is the end of my comments.
Thank you, and I know you're going to have to leave, but we're going to go ahead, Representative Oliver, if you could cover the other sections, and then if you're willing to take all the questions, that'd be great.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm very happy to be here, and I appreciate the privilege of presenting another opportunity for the state to move forward on mental health reform. Madam Chair, that might be a good spot to pause, and I'm happy to answer questions or proceed any way you would like.
Questions from the committee? You have one question?
I can ask him later. I did answer him later. Okay. Chairman Oliver, thank you for being here. A couple questions, and we can take some of these offline if we need to. I just wanted to understand some of the operative things that are important in this. One thing that comes up in Section 3 of the bill, the definition of serious mental illness. What exactly that a lot hinges on that definition in this bill, and as it sort of works outside and doing its work, what hinges on that definition? What kinds of decisions? And Madam Chair, I raise the question because the delegation that happens here and the agency is going to be they're going to get about their business quickly. They're going to define this by December of 23. Important things are going to hinge on that definition, and it seems to me that is the province of the General Assembly to determine those kinds of if legally significant things are going to hinge on a definition. You know, we're in the business when we do our good work. And I know you've seen good work here, you've seen bad work here.
I've seen them.
When we do our good work, we write definitions that because so much hinges on. I'm concerned a delegation that's going to have this much impact legally, and there's other settings we don't have time to talk through. That's a concern.
Representative, one of the things that has come up throughout the bill is referring to definitions that haven't been developed yet, and we're pretty protective in the General Assembly about defining things. We're going to limit individuals to 2 minutes.
So I have questions about conflict of interest within the bill. Public-private partnerships have historically been financial gain for the lead agency, the nonprofits, and perhaps the executive committees to the detriment of the stakeholders. These have been employed by various HHS and Georgia State Health agencies since the 70s. They are controlled by those who give grants and private foundations and who give money or corporate sponsors. They eliminate accountability with the general public. There's also a conflict of interest when it comes to a lot of the organizations involved because they're backed by psychopharma.
We welcome the input from this committee to better the bill and to improve it. We always like to have good discussion on any bill that comes forth, especially one of this nature.
The lead sponsor for the bill owns a company who stands to benefit from its passing. That is because he owns a monitoring company that does monitoring that is described in the bill. He stands to gain from this. He and his partners stand to gain from this bill passing, and he's putting funding and he's putting grants in order to fund these different aspects of health.
Madam Chair, I wonder if that would be appropriate for his testimony to be when Chairman Jones is here. Sounds a little bit unfair.
Chairman Jones had the opportunity to be here.
Yeah.
He's defined what his product does, which is a monitoring device. It monitors biometrics as well as GPS. So he's defined in the bill what his particular device actually does that's patented.
The bill needs perfection, of course. I used to work for the Senate. I know you will do your job and perfect this bill. Absolutely, positively. What is mental health? What is mental illness? What is serious mental illness? What is monitoring? HB 520 cites these things numerous times. Who monitors? How do you monitor? Are these going to use Chinese components, pieces, and parts for monitoring? Who maintains the data? What if the company that's there sells their company? Then what happens to the data? Presumably, these questions will be left up to a few elite mental health czars.
Georgia is at the beginning of a journey to transform mental health and substance use care in the state. The studies and task forces will create the map for that journey. Absent a map, Georgia's journey will be aimless and costly, both in terms of individual health outcomes and taxpayer funds. The studies and task forces will provide transparency and accountability for the journey.
I have several arguments about HB 520, but the one that I'd like to highlight today is that this bill addresses mental health issues, yet does not mention the root cause. That is concerning. What is the root cause of the mental illness issues we're seeing? Prior to the pandemic, those numbers and the ones we have today, vastly different. Why? And you have not, as the bill gives testimony to, done the studies, defined the terms, and put your finger on the root cause. To the average citizen, that screams government. We don't want more government. The private sector has some amazing organizations that are addressing with compassion, with empathy, with efficiency and ingenuity, these groups that need help. Why would we not first give the private sector the opportunity to do this, to do it well, to outperform government, which is historically the record? And why would we sideline that, not even have that be a discussion?
We believe that HB 520 is creating a modern, evidence-based system that serves all Georgians, including our foreign-born communities.
During the invocation, I believe I heard an invitation for hard questions. So let's have a couple. I heard Representative Jones speak to, there's so much in here that's in previous bills and has been there for many years. But isn't it your job to look at the law in place and amend or add to things that make sense for the time? He also talked about the two affidavit issue. Like most parts of the law, I believe, it's open to use, but unfortunately could be open to misuse. These things are not about the way that they are stated in the bill, perhaps. Sometimes they're about looking for the holes in between that open the possibility of misuse. Why is virtually every provider, every firm, every association that will be associated with this bill given full immunity from both civil and criminal penalties? Why would they need criminal immunity?
Madam Chair, of course I leave this to your discretion. There might be a couple of points that require some response, but I'll leave that to your discretion either today or later.
Part of this bill is to allow information to be passed from one entity to another to facilitate better care for patients.
I have gone through this bill and I have several concerns, some of which would be repetition as far as the definitions are concerned. The data sharing, I have a real concern with. One of the things I did when Candy was right, the criminal justice information system grant, so I had to learn all that engineering stuff. And I know that there is a way to share information. At the same time, I also am very aware of the fact that there is no such thing as real encryption. That there is, people can encrypt it, but there is many people who can unencrypt it as can encrypt it. The federal government has now put pregnancy and reproductive health as part of behavioral health and has allowed abortion services to be readdressed under behavioral health. And with that, pregnancy was mentioned in the bill, but I don't know that people are thoroughly aware of the fact that this is a backdoor to abortion services.
We are very supportive of this bill, and specifically the increase in coverage options for current Medicaid members and an increase in the services.
Thanks to everyone for coming down. Stay tuned. This is a long process. We're just the beginning of it. Thanks very much. We're adjourned.